Good morning. I hope you are all at your houses, staying safe against the current global pandemic. However, we cannot waste time, or as aptly said, an idle mind is the devil's workplace. So I thought we will have some online lectures on some basic concepts of preventive medicine. So in this regard, this is first of the hopefully many series of video lectures, about some 20 minutes long video lectures that can be helpful for your syllabus. So actually the first lesson will be on how infections happen and how do they spread and how they are maintained in a population. So why does infections happen? The aim of a pathogen is never to cause infection, cause harm to its host and let the host die. The aim or the life goal of a pathogen is of course to infect, but that may or may not produce a disease. However, its aim is to reproduce in a population and survive and then find another host that can it can infect with. This whole process is known as the life cycle of the host. Now, knowing this life cycle is very important for controlling the diseases. So to control an infectious disease, first of all, you have to know how does the organism procreate inside a host and find another host so that it can establish a successful infection so that the chain moves on. Another important feature is that we have to know the mode of transmission and how the organism or the infectious agent is maintained in that ecology. So transmission of disease can either be horizontally transmitted or vertical. Horizontal transmission means the disease is transmitted from one population to another. So the disease is transmitted from a susceptible or an infected group or an infected population to a susceptible population. Now this can be direct or indirect transmission. So when it comes to direct transmission, it involves physical contact, or it can be the contact with the infected secretions and excretions of the host. However, for indirect transmission, it needs a vehicle, and this vehicle can be live or inanimate. Whatever be the case, it is called as a vector. Another mechanism of transmission is vertical transmission. So what happens in vertical transmission? In vertical transmission, the infection is transferred from one generation to the next, or from the mother to its offspring. So this can be in ovo in case of reptiles, birds and all, and it is called as in utero, or it is in utero in case of mammals. Now there is a third condition or a different situation where, you know, the kid is infected by drinking the milk from the mother. So where will you place this? Is this a case of horizontal transmission or vertical transmission? It is actually a case of horizontal transmission. However, a better or one group of experts say that such cases are known as pseudo-vertical transmission. Another example of a pseudo-vertical transmission will be cases of salmonellosis in chicks, where the infection is acquired from the contamination on the surface of the shell, not from the, not when the chick comes through the, or when the embryo or the egg comes and picks up infection from the uterus of the bird, but from the contamination of the shell. Okay, so so these are the mechanisms of transmission. Now, one important or two important participants in the epidemiological triad are the host and the agent. Now, what is a host? Host is any organism that is capable of being infected with. A host is any organism that is capable of being infected with. Now, the host, or the concept of host, has or it is classified to many groups, and these are the classifications. So, a definitive host is an agent, or the host wherein the agent reaches sexual maturity. Now, this is a this is not a general term, but rather parasitological in origin. So, a definitive host is the host wherein the parasite reaches sexual maturity. A more general term will be final host. It actually indicates the ambition of a pathogen, or where the pathogen wants to end up with. So, that particular host is termed a final host. And of course, a definitive host is the final host wherever a pathogen is concerned. Now, a primary or a natural host is that animal that maintains, or the population of that animal, or the population of animals that maintain the infection. And this is also known as the maintenance host. Now, infections are normally maintained in a maintenance host, or infection sustains itself, or the organism sustains itself in this maintenance or natural host. But sometimes what happens is that another additional host becomes involved in the life cycle, which is not usually seen in the area where that particular disease is endemic. Now, these hosts can also be called as other end hosts. A paratenic host is that particular animal that carries the infection mechanically. Now, again, this is a parasitological term, and you can call a vector or an arthropod vector that carries mechanically a disease, or that mechanically carries a disease, as a mechanical vector. So, the entomological term for a paratenic host is a mechanical vector. Then we have intermediate host. So, intermediate host is nothing but the host where the agent undergoes some development. So, the agent in this case undergoes some development, but it will never reach sexual maturity in this particular case. Then we have amplifier host. Amplifier hosts are those hosts where, you know, the agent is able to amplify itself. Now, this can be because of the agent's ability to produce a large number of or reproduce in a very large number compared to other hosts, or there will be some temporal characteristics where the host itself undergoes rapid replication, or the host itself produces a large number of offsprings. One typical case will be in case of pigs, where the virus itself can multiply in huge titers within the pig host, like in case of FMD. Or the along with the fact that the pigs produce large number of piglets in a breeding season, so that a large number of host is available for rapid multiplication of this particular virus. So, those are amplifier hosts. Then another terminology is hibernating host, where the host is holding the pathogen or the agent in a state of suspended animation. Then we have an term called incidental or dead end or accidental host, and it is said that this accidental host never, or incidental or dead end host, never transmit an infection to another agent. Then we have link host, where this particular host act as link between two species. Example can be Japanese encephalitis, where pig act as a link host between birds and humans. So the infection from birds is transmitted to pigs, and from pigs humans acquire this infection. So pig act as a link host between birds and humans. Okay, right. Now the another group of, or another important host is called as a reservoir host, or generally we call as reservoir. And the reservoirs are the host where the agent generally normally lives and multiplies. They sustain the infection in an endemic area. Understand is that a reservoir host is not a maintenance host, or both are different in meaning, because maintenance host simply maintains a disease or maintains an agent in a population, but reservoir host not only maintains, but it should act as a source of infection to a susceptible group or another species of a susceptible host. Now that means there should be a target population for reservoir. So whenever we are describing some organism as a reservoir host, whenever we are describing some organism as a reservoir host, we should incorporate three factors. So those are, what is the agent, what organism or what species of animal act as the reservoir host, and they transmit to which target species. So if you are talking about blue tongue, so blue tongue virus is the agent, and cattle act as a reservoir host. Now simply telling cattle act as reservoir host will not mean anything, but you should also say that, or it should also be implied that cattle will act as a source of infection to sheep. Thus cattle act as a reservoir host for blue tongue virus, which serve as a source of infection to sheep. Okay, so those are the classification of various hosts. So we have, just to recap, we have definite host, definitive host, final host means it is a more general term for a definitive host. We have primary or natural host, which maintains the infection, which is also known as a maintenance host. Then secondary host, wherein these hosts come into contact with the primary host and pick up the infection. Then there are paratenic or mechanical vectors. Intermediate host, you all may be knowing. Amplifier host, you all may be knowing, which help in rapid multiplication of the organism. Hibernating host, see, hibernating host can be a host that is hibernating also. Like for example, certain snakes undergo hibernation, and these snakes may be carrying Japanese encephalitis virus, and once their hibernating season is over and when they become active they can spread infection to other species. So those are hibernating hosts. Then you have incidental or dead end host. Well known example is rabies and human. Then we have link host and reservoirs of infection. Right. Now when we talk about a case of horizontal transmission, we have to also talk about the case of direct and mediated transmission. So this is a paradigm where you can see that there is an infected host, and it is transmitting an infection to a susceptible host. This can be through direct, that is by physical contact, or when the organism, when the susceptible host come into contact with the excretion and secretion of the infected animals, or infected excretions and secretions, or through a vector. Here vector means it can be animate or inanimate object. Now, so when we talk about vector, as I told, vector can be living or non-living, and non-living agents that transmit infections are known as fomites rather than vector, and the term vector is specifically reserved for living things that can transmit infectious agent. And we generally talk, when we talk about vector, it is considered rather as an entomological term rather than a general term. Anyway, vectors are classified as either mechanical or biological vectors. So when in case of mechanical vector, the it is just as we told earlier, they are paratenic in nature. That means no physical or physiological or biological changes take place in case of a mechanical vector. So there won't be any physical physiological or biological changes for the parasite inside a mechanical vector. But if any of such changes happen in a vector, then that organism is called as a biological vector. So the inside a biological vector, two things can happen. Either the parasite may undergo any developmental changes without any developmental changes without multiplication, or may simply multiply, or both of these can happen. So when a vector undergoes only developmental changes without multiplication, these are known as a case of developmental transmission. If there is only multiplication happening, for example looping eel virus inside mosquitoes, so the virus will only multiply, there won't be any physiological or biological transformation of this organism. Those are known as propagative cases of propagative transmission. And when the organism undergoes both physiological and replication, physiological changes or developmental changes and replication, then those cases of transmission are known as cyclopropagative transmission. So another thing is that these biological vectors are either intermediate host or definitive host. It is never a case where all the vectors are intermediate host. So we may be knowing that the vectors like for example ticks for Babesia, they are intermediate host. But when we consider Plasmodium in mosquitoes are the agent where the Plasmodium undergoes sexual maturity, or the sexual reproduction happens inside the mosquitoes. So the vectors can either be definitive or intermediate host. So when we talk about biological vectors, or where the agent undergoes developmental changes, there can be migration inside the vector involved. Now this is exemplified by cases of trypanosomosis. In case of African trypanosomosis, where the agent multiplies inside the Glossina fly, the fly ingests the organism and the organism reaches the midgut, and what happens is that the organism or the agent will migrate into the salivary gland, and when the fly Glossina fly goes and infects another vertebrate host, what happens is that the infectious organism is inoculated through the bite, or inoculated into the system through the bite of the fly. So this movement from gut to the salivary gland is known as salivarian transmission. And when it comes to the American trypanosomosis, what happens is that the migration is from the midgut to the feces or into the rectum, and the organism moves or is the organism is voided along with the feces, and what happens is that when the triatom bug bite, they will leave a wound. And another habit is that this bug has a habit of defecating near this wound, and because of the itching, the infected feces is rubbed onto the wound, where the trypanosoma gains access for infecting the host. So if it the movement from or the migration from gut to the hindgut or exit through feces is called as a stercorarian transmission, and if it is moving from the gut to saliva, it is known as salivarian transmission, as seen in African trypanosomosis and glossina flies. So this completes our first session on maintenance of infection and the classification of hosts and vectors. So we will meet in the next class, and we'll discuss on how infections are, how do infections spread among a susceptible population. Thank you.